The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
This show is based on true events. We may use audio, transcripts, and other media to show the true graphic nature of predators. For legal purposes, this is our research. We are not legal, mental, or medical professionals and do not claim to be. This show is meant to educate and create change in how we deal with predators and the survivors of their abuse. If you or someone else observes someone being abused, please seek help and report it. Some subjects may be disturbing for some individuals. You've been warned. Hello and welcome to tonight's show. It is Friday on Armed Radio, and I'm your host, Kasy, for this episode of Betrayal. And you can listen to our show anytime you want to. You can download it from Spreaker, from iTunes, from iHeartRadio, from right here, and you can listen to it whenever you are ready to listen to it, or you can listen to it live every Friday from 10 to 11 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. Now, my book, The Devil's Business, which, believe it or not, when I did the show about the Sharon Tate murders, about the Manson murders, it prompted me to ask a lot of questions about the murders themselves, about motive, about a variety of things. And through my research, I found questions that even other people have about the murders that were never really have never been answered, to be quite honest. And so that prompted me to write a book. Now, originally the book was going to be basically like an activity book, but where you could put the pieces together, because I wanted people to think about the crime and come to your own conclusions. But then I thought, you know, I don't know how I could put something together like that and not be, to me, it was in poor taste. So I decided to change it to a book about the timeline of the murders, and also the evidence of the murder and the trial evidence of the murders, because if you actually read that information, which, you know, a lot of this information is available, YouTube, everything like that, but take the time to actually read, digest what is being said in these words, this testimony, the timeline, because you're going to find loopholes in this timeline between the different perpetrators of this murder, recounting their story, recounting their excuses. And what I have watched so many videos on various aspects of the Sharon Tate murder. Doris Tate, which is Sharon Tate's mother, I have a huge amount of respect and admiration for this woman. This woman is almost like keen to my heart, basically, because she became an advocate through tragedy. And whenever I am writing the Betrayal series and discussing this show, Betrayal, this is me being an advocate for those who cannot speak, for those who've been victimized by crime, because I agree with her. Victims have zero rights when it comes to crime. It is the perpetrator, it's the criminals who are given all the rights, who are given all the therapy at no cost, where the victims get none of that. And I think that that is a huge disservice, tragedy, that victims are punished more so than the perpetrators. I think that's wrong. And Doris Tate, you know, shares that, you know, same philosophy as I do on that. And I'm sure a lot of other people do too. So, with the success and with the buzz, if you will, of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, which is doing, you know, phenomenal at the box office, there is a lot of interest in the Sharon Tate murders. In fact, it's been 50 years now. It is August 2019. These murders happened in 1969. It was a Friday, August the 8th, into early hours of August the 9th, that these tragedies occurred. And then the additional murders happened that night, which would have been August the 9th. These murders were so graphic, so horrible. It, to this day, before the O.J. Simpson, up until the O.J. Simpson murders, even the Amy Fisher, even the Menendez murders do not match the brutality of the Manson and the O.J. murders. And I say the O.J. Simpson murders because he was, I mean, that's who was the famous trial for. I'm not going to say he was innocent, because I personally believe he's not innocent. I personally believe, and also Mr., and I'm not going to say his name correctly, Pelosi, who was the prosecuting attorney for the Manson murders, and who won, even he said, because the fact is that in 1994 to 95, we did not understand blood forensics. We did not understand DNA evidence. And so because we did not understand DNA evidence, we let go a person who would have been easily convicted of that. That is his words on that matter. I happen to agree with those words. I believe, based upon what I've heard, based upon, and I believe it actually even more now after what OJ has said about the murders. How would he know about it if he was in Chicago or on his way to Chicago? He would have been in the air when these murders are occurring. But he seems to know a lot of pertinent information, a lot of information that's what we call intimate information, that only people who are intimately involved or there would know about it. And when I'm not referring to intimacy because it's his ex-wife or anything like that. No, I'm referring intimately, like you had to be there to know this information. How would you know this person did this or that? And we need to look at all those pieces of information. And, you know, Doris Tate touches on this. And this is a interview. Oh my gosh, you guys. This is some heavy stuff. and actually, that's a 1960s term, heavy. And I don't mean to make light of anything. But this audio that you're about to hear is Doris Tate, in her own words. She's at the parole hearing of Tex Watson. And you're going to hear the parole hearing from start to finish. Now, Miss Tate, Mrs. Tate, you know, she's passed on. And so, she's passed on and she's been reunited with her daughter. Her husband, who is, Mr. Tate, he was in the military. Very high up in the military. Let's just say this man was, you know, very much a person who could kick booty. And Charles Manson, who's now deceased, he said that the only man he feared in this world was Paul Tate, which is Mrs. Tate's husband. And Paul Tate was the one he feared the most, Charles Manson. There are people who said that when they looked into Charles Manson's eyes, when he tried to put the whammy on them, they was like staring into hell itself. And everything. This man was super creepy. Creepy. And the reason why I'm passionate about victims' rights is because, and another reason why I wanted to write that book is because, you know, I believe that Charles Manson, who you can find on t-shirts, on mugs, and various different things, his music has been, you know, put out there because he's so notorious. Now, if he hadn't committed these crimes, or he didn't physically commit the Sharon Tate crime, he didn't wield the knife, but he certainly ordered his minions to do so, and he had control over these minions through manipulation, lies, and deception and intimidation. Now, because of his, you know, ability to control these people, he gave the order and they followed an order, almost like the military, when you follow orders and everything. So these people went out and did the devil's business, as Tex Watson said. And that's why I called the book The Devil's Business, because there was nothing good about what this man did. It was 100% evil. And to this day, you know, Miss Tate never once heard from Tex Watson. On she went to every single parole hearing until her death. And I'm sure in spirit, she is there with every single parole hearing. Her daughter, Doris Tate, who was 16 at the time that her older sister passed away. Doris Tate, as far as I understand and everything, I could be wrong. I'm probably not wrong, but I'm just going to throw that out there. I might be wrong. I doubt it. I believe when her mother passed away, and that she took up the mantle, and that she's been to every parole hearing since her mother's passing to ensure that none, zero, of the Manson family get paroled and then put out on the streets to where they're around us. Not one time, not one single solitary time, did any one of these perpetrators ever look the victim's family, which is the mother, the sister, or the father, in the face and say, after all the drugs have worn off, after finding Jesus, after finding religion, whatever religion it was, they found Christianity, they say they found Christianity, that's between them and God. Not one time. And reading the Bible verses, reading all that Bible, being so devoutly Christian, not one of them has ever, ever looked the victims in the victim's family, their survivors in their eyes, and say, I committed a crime that was horrendous. I was under the influence of drugs and a mad person. I made a bad decision. And you shouldn't even say that. Not one of them said, I'm sorry. I truly regret what I did. Not one of them said, I made a mistake. I did the wrong thing. And I deserve to be in jail to serve. I deserve to be in jail because I committed a crime. And I deserve to be in here so that I can spend the rest of my life reflecting on the horrendous deeds that I did outside. I can spend the rest of my life teaching those who are in the jails, who are there along with me, Christianity. I can teach them that my mistakes, my horrendous mistakes, don't repeat those mistakes for those who can go outside, who can get paroled. I do not deserve to be paroled. Not one of them has said, I don't deserve to be paroled. They only think of themselves. I should be out on parole because I've got a family. I should be out on parole because I'm sick. I should be out on parole because I'm old and I can't do anything now. I should be on parole because I've served, you know, X amount of years and I've been a good citizen inside the jail. I should be on the parole because I found Christianity. I should be on the parole. It's all I. It's all selfish driven. It's what they want. It's not what the victims, what's right for the victims. Sometimes in this world, you have to think of not what's right for yourself. Yes, you don't want to be controlled everything that you do for the rest of your life. What you eat, what you watch, what you wear, which is a jumpsuit that is, you know, that you want to go out, you want to explore the world, but you gave up that right in 1969 when you committed these crimes. You did not have to go, you know, to that cult, to that person. You had the choice of leaving that situation. Manson was only as strong and only as influential as the people allowed him to be. If you don't agree with what he was saying, you thought he was a nut, then you could have left. Other than that, guess what, you guys? I'm going to start a cult. I'm going to start controlling people. I don't know what I'm going to call it, but maybe we'll call it the unicorn cult. I like unicorns. And or, you know, rainbows and sparkly things, you know, type of thing. And if it was that easy that I could just go up to some random people and say, you know what, I started a cult. It's the rainbow sparkly unicorn cult. People are going to laugh at me. They're going to say, you're full of stuff. You're full of poo. So there was a reason why people were attracted to Manson. And there was a reason why how did they find out about him? He was in Spawn Ranch, which is in the boonies in 1969. In the boonies, like way far away. And a lot of those people didn't even drive. How did they find him? Oh, they went to certain parties and they found him. You had to have had some sort of connection with that person. A like thinking process, if you will. With that being said, I wanted to do something different. I would like for you to listen to these audios, which I actually watched the video of these audios, of Doris Tate. All right, so going back to my thought process before I got a text message, I keep getting more text messages. The thing is that there had to been some sort of like thought process on these things. You just don't, out of the blue, you know, it's just unfathomable. Also, in these audios, there's a man, and I don't remember his name, but he's the one who's conducting the interview with Miss Doris Tate, which is the mother of Sharon Tate. He actually, before the, so this had been before 1993, 94, because house was, you know, leveled, and now there's a huge mega mansion there, which, you know, it's still there, and they changed the address. Well, what happened was that he actually went to the address before the building was demolished. And, you know, he, based on Tex Watson's testimony, he climbed up the hill that Tex supposedly climbed up. And he said he slid down that hill several times. And he says it was impossible for Tex Watson to have gone up that hill and everything. He says it was also probably very unlikely, even though the wires were cut, that he scaled up this pole. And a lot of things that they were saying that they did to gain entry into the home, he kind of debunked on there. Also, Sharon Tate's mother said that the caretaker in the cottage who claims that he was there during the murders, she said that one of the perpetrators actually went into the caretaker cottage and went through it and didn't find anyone there. Now, the caretaker said that he was there all night listening to music at a certain amount of decibels, and they actually say what the decibels are in this interview. And they kind of are trying to debunk what this caretaker said, because a lot of what the caretaker said does not match. And how did he not hear gunshot fires? Because there are people, neighbors, over 100 yards away who heard gunfire. There were, I guess, Boy Scouts, you know, in the area camping who heard the gunfire. In fact, to the point that they got in their car and they were investigating because they heard a person saying, "Oh God, no, please stop, please don't hurt me," something like that. They'll say what the actual words were. And they got in their car to look around to see if there was anyone in, you know, hurt, and they couldn't find anyone. So, and there was also a record amount of heat during that time. And just a lot of things do not add up to what was the testimony. They also said that Tex Watson, after they were believed to be deceased, was cutting up Sharon Tate's body and all the victims' bodies up even further. So there's a lot of discrepancies between everyone's, you know, words of who killed who was wrong. They were all trying to pin it on Tex, and Tex was trying to say it was everybody, and or Tex was also saying it was drug induced, all their excuses. But I want you to listen to this audio. I want you to hear the woman's words, because this is the mother of Sharon Tate in her own words, and I think it's just very powerful information, and I just think it should be shared. And, you know, continue to show your support of the book, and, you know, continue to learn from these tragedies, and let's not repeat those tragedies. Let's do better as people. But here are the audios from those interviews. The first one is going to be the parole hearing for Tex Watson and Doris Tate, talking about why he should not be paroled. All right.
I might say that I feel sorry for this man, that he chose this way of life and was choosing. There is no way of turning back. You cannot, or society cannot, and I'm not reading notes, cannot. They cannot trust you living next door to them. What mercy, sir, did you show my daughter when she was begging for her life? What mercy did you show my daughter when she says, "Give me 2 weeks to have my baby, and then you can kill me"? What mercy did you show her? In 21 years, I would like to have asked this prisoner why. He did not know my daughter. He had never seen her, but not that I know of. She'd only been home for 2 weeks. How can an individual, without knowing, without any abrasive feelings toward an individual, go in and slice them up? And this mother, 8.5 months pregnant, what about her family? What about her family? And what about the family that she was going to have, sir? Is that not a family? I saw how your feathers ruffled when you was talking about your family. What about my family? When will she come up for parole? When will I come up for parole? Can you tell me that? Are these seven victims and possibly more going to walk out of their graves when you get paroled? Yes, I feel sorry for anyone that has chosen that way of life. But if you can tell me one person that wants to live next door to you with your children or with their children, I'll eat my hat. You cannot be trusted. You know, I find it very unusual. I heard today Mr. Watson's age was 22. He was born in 1945 in Dallas, Texas. Sharon was born in 1943 in Dallas, Texas. I find that very unusual. And I might remind, faith has nothing to do with release. If we do, we can open the doors for all inmates throughout California. Let's open the door for Ramirez. Let's open the door for Randy Kraft. We can't do that, okay, because they are on death row. Remembering back when this man was on death row, but for a fluke, when the death penalty was overturned, his sentence was commuted to life, okay? It took California 3 months to get enough signatures to get that death penalty back on the ballot and was passed by some 80%. I do not feel that the people of California could accept the fact that a serial killer could be released into society ever again. Now rest my case.
Thank you, Mr. Tate. You're excused. Back to everybody's excuse. Prisoner leaves for
Charles Watson, drug crazed, amphetamine induced, went with Susan Atkins, Patricia Krenwinkel, and Linda Kasabian to do the bidding of Charles Manson. He sent them up there actually to kill a lot of people on that street. In 1969, we were in the middle of a hot season, about four nights of extreme heat. It was not uncommon, they tell me, for the people to actually have their windows open to get some air in the canyon. That night, Tex Watson drove the car right up to the gate. Quietly, he scaled the telephone pole. Scaling the telephone pole, he cut the wires, four of them. He came back down, got in the car, a 1959 white and yellow Ford. They drove the Ford just down the street, just to the bottom of the hill. They walked back up, leaving Linda Kasabian in the car to watch and listen for sounds. Walking up the driveway, they decided that they were going to be jeopardized when a car was coming down the street, coming down the driveway. A young man who just happened to be there that night by the name of Stephen Parent. Stephen Parent was a young man that wanted to sell a stereo to the man who was taking care of the property for the owner. Steve Parent came down and Tex Watson gave a command for them all to duck in the bushes and hide. Tex Watson jumps out of the bushes. He has a 9-inch barreled gun. It was a bunt line. He took this gun and he pointed it at the chest and the face of a man named Stephen Parent. Young Stephen Parent said, "Please don't hurt me." The answer he got from Tex Watson was four shots in the chest. They then went into the residence and they began the mayhem and murder, inflicting more than 100 stab wounds on four individuals. I'm told through reports that when Tex Watson returned to the Spahn Ranch, he actually was chewed out by Manson. Charles Manson, dancing naked in front of the saloon at the Spahn Ranch with another female partner. He chewed Watson out because he said, "Why are you back so soon?" To which Watson replied, "Well, we killed them, and it was fun." And Watson was in trouble for not staying and killing other people on that street. Sunset Boulevard, just in front of me, Hollywood. Just behind me, Benedict Canyon. The scenery hasn't changed much since 1969. But Charles Manson made sure of one thing. He made sure that there would be a new direction of murder. Mass murder, ritualistic murder, even satanic murders. 1969.
Doris, I understand that at the time of the murders, you were in San Francisco visiting your military husband. That's what Mr. Bugliosi says as he writes Helter Skelter, and that you had tried to call Sharon during the day, during the morning, but were unable to reach her. Were you in San Francisco?
I had just left San Francisco. We had been stationed there for 3 years. He was retiring. My husband was, Sharon's father was retiring. And then I came home to get the house ready for the new baby, to be ready and to help her in her last month of pregnancy.
You were in Los Angeles.
I was in Los Angeles when this occurred. I was never notified by the police, and I'm not sure that I don't thank God that I was not notified first, okay, because I could have been. They did know that Sharon's father was stationed at the Presidio in San Francisco, so they reached him first.
Where did Mr. Bugliosi, the prosecutor, get this information for Helter Skelter? Did he talk to you about where you were?
Never. Never.
They invent these things?
Sure. Where else do they come from?
It sells books?
Well, the fact that when he says, I was there visiting, it makes it sound like, we're separated and I just went to see him.
Or that he was in the military and you reside in Los Angeles.
Exactly.
The night of the murders.
Yes.
You have two other daughters, Deborah and Patty.
Yes.
Deborah had called Sharon at about 6 to 6:30 at night. She had asked Sharon if she could come with a friend and stay all night. Sharon, being late in her pregnancy, thought, maybe not tonight, I'm a little tired.
And she was.
You came very close to possibly losing two daughters that night.
I know.
You ever think about that?
Well, you see, it was Friday. And she had been home, about 3 weeks. We had watched that moonshot with her.
July 20th?
Yeah, July 20th. She had just got home, okay, from Europe. And her father as well. And that was the last time he saw her, by the way.
Whose house did you watch that film clip?
At that house.
At that house?
Yeah.
You're quite familiar with that residence then?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Been there a lot?
Yes.
Knew it as well as Tex Watson did.
Well, now, I'm not going to say that, okay, knew it as well as he did, because my suspicions are that he had been up there many times before.
He says that's true.
Is that right?
He does.
Now, you know, Bill, since I have not read any of the books, that I'm talking off of my feelings, and you're talking from knowledge or what they have said.
Well, I didn't have a daughter brutally murdered up there, so yeah. I can read the books.
That's
and
right.
I've read probably 19 to 20 of those. And I like it that you haven't read it, because I can get your reaction to some of the things that were said in the books. Going back to Deborah.
Yes.
Has this bothered her at all? I mean, she could have been a victim. She could have been a guest there that night. They had asked to stay and sleep up in the loft. Tex Watson says they went up in the loft to see if anybody was there. She could have been a victim.
Oh, absolutely. But, you know, we could have all been there that night. Because since she, since she had only been home for 2.5-3 weeks, mm-hmm. okay, we would go up there on Friday because the children were out of school.
What
ages
were your children?
And why we were not there is beyond me.
What ages were your children at that time?
At that time, 10 and 16.
And Sharon was 26.
Yes.
How about Deborah? How does she handle this? She ever think about it?
Oh, I know they think about it. You can tell how it has affected their lives as adults. Very protective of the children.
Mm-hmm.
And they do not allow this to be shown to me because they figure that I am all consumed with enough grief.
Patty the same way?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
There were a lot of rumors at the time of the murder. I'm curious how you handle that emotionally. For instance, many of the books talk about possible sex orgies, bondage, drugs. A lot of rumors in the press. Even in Helter Skelter, they talk about that. How did you as a mother deal with that? Even the coroner, Noguchi, suggested marijuana.
I'm glad you said Noguchi.
Well, he did. He suggested marijuana remains next to Sharon's bed.
Yes.
But Roman Polanski says no, she didn't use any drugs, at least during that time, because she was very concerned about being pregnant. How does a mother handle this? Go back 21 years. How'd you handle these kind of rumors?
Rumors.
Mm-hmm. Innuendo.
Not very well, okay? What had gone before, now remember that Sharon had only been home 2.5-3 weeks at the most, okay? Whatever was going on at that house prior to her coming home bothered her a great deal.
Are you kidding?
No, it bothered her.
Roman says that Sharon was either too dumb or too naive to know what Abigail Folger and Frykowski were doing.
Naive.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Naive, yes. But she wasn't so naive that night that she called Roman and wanted these people out of the house.
That's not in any of the books, my dear.
Well, it may not be in the books, but that's what happened.
She knew the drugs
and
that were going on.
And so does Roman know that. Roman knows that he couldn't get home quick enough for her to be settled and ready to have that baby. Oh, but let's don't forget Noguchi and the marijuana residue that was at the side of her bed. Now, who did the autopsy, Bill?
Noguchi requested to do Sharon's.
And he did do Sharon's
autopsy. Yes, he
autopsy,
did. And found nothing.
And he found absolutely not even nicotine.
But in all honesty, didn't Jay Sebring use? And he was on the bed that time in conversation with Sharon when Susan Atkins went in and told them to come into the living room. So is it possible that Jay Sebring had used and they knew very well that it was remains residual from him?
It's possible. All I can say truthfully is that Sharon was absolutely clean. Mm-hmm. Noguchi, who wrote the book, what was the name
Corner
of the book?
Corner to the Stars.
Corner
is that right?
to the Stars, knew that, and yet he intimated that she was smoking pot while 8.5 months pregnant. And yet he knew different. That burns me.
That burns you?
Yeah, that burns me.
Let me give you some adjectives to describe Sharon, your daughter.
Okay.
Sweet?
Yes.
Innocent?
Yes.
Nice?
Yes.
Naive?
Right.
Any others?
Yes, but you see, with you saying them, it's okay. If I say them, I'm just prejudiced, Bill. Okay?
Sure.
She was very naive. Up until she was 21, she was a ward of the courts.
Who was?
Sharon was.
Why?
Because you had to be a ward of the courts if you were making movies under contract before you were 21.
Okay.
And she was a ward of the courts. She was. We at that time were stationed at Fort MacArthur, which is Los Angeles, coming straight from Italy into the very environment that she wanted to pursue. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Again, who knows? Why would it be Los Angeles? I never wanted Sharon in the movies. And yet everything that came to Italy picked on her. A lot of films were being made in Italy at that time. And if they needed an extra or something, they'd call the American base, which is Passalacqua. And then Passalacqua would get in touch with Major Tate, I think it was at that time. And or Sharon directly, mostly Sharon directly, because Papa probably wouldn't have given her the message.
Let's bring it to the night of the murders.
All right.
Outside the residence, up the incline, up the hill.
Yes.
The gate, the button on the gate.
Yes.
The telephone pole.
Right.
Tex Watson says, I got on the hood of the car, 1959 yellow and white Ford. I went up the telephone pole and I cut four wires. He says before he left the Spahn Ranch, that he got a Gerber jar filled with acid, snuffed it, snorted it, smelled it, higher than a kite, all of them were. Yet he says he went up the telephone pole, and then he says that not to open the gate because it may have set off an alarm, they scaled the hill adjacent to the right. As you know, I've been to that residence. It's a very steep hill.
Yes, it is.
I tried to climb that hill 2 weeks ago. I slid down.
No kidding.
It's very hard. There's nothing to grab hold of.
And yet he said that they were on amphetamines.
The LSD.
And the
acid,
telephone pole
things.
Was 16 foot high?
60 feet high. And he
How
climbed
many?
It. What,
How many?
Whatever.
Yeah, okay.
And it's also hanging on a cliff. There's
yes,
nothing
it is.
On the other side of it.
Yes.
They went into the residence, and they found Wojtek asleep on the couch, Frykowski. And he awoke, dazed, sleepy. And he said, "Who are you? What do you want?" And Tech said, "Shut up or I'll kill you. I want your money." They went to the back bedroom and found Abigail Folger. They brought her out there in a white nightgown. Then Susan Atkins was sent down the hallway after they had checked the premises to report to Tex Watson how many people were in the residence. She went back and found J.C. Bring and Sharon Tate on the bed having a normal platonic conversation and escorted them into the living room. They asked for money. Abigail Folger gave them $75, $73. They can't remember which figure, but in the 70s. Tex Watson, in his book, Will You Die For Me, says, "We went there to rob them, to raise $600 to get Mary Bruner out of jail, to raise bail." You and I both know that there was money left all over that place and credit
yes.
cards, and there was money next to Sharon's bed.
Yes.
What do you think the motive was?
According to what I hear at the parole hearings, it was to start a race war between the blacks and the whites.
Helter skelter.
Helter skelter. And no one can make me believe any differently. They didn't go there for money.
But that's what he says in his book.
Well, they can say anything they want in a book. He says lots of things at the parole hearings, by the way, as well.
Let me read to you something you've not read.
Okay.
You may not have heard.
I haven't read any of them.
From
so.
Susan Watkins, or Susan Atkins.
Yes.
Quote, as Sharon pleaded for her life, sitting on the couch, Susan says, "It felt so good the first time I stabbed her. And when she screamed at me, it did something to me. Sent a rush through me. I stabbed her again. I just kept stabbing her until she stopped screaming. It was just like going into nothing when the girl in the jail who became the snitch, the informant, said, 'Like a pillow?' And she said, 'Yes, like going into air.' That person had stabbed an ex-lover, so she knew what it was to stab someone." Here's what Susan Atkins finally said to the person in jail. "It's like a sexual release, especially when you see the blood spurting out. It's better than a climax." That was your daughter.
That's right.
Susan Atkins now says she's got a new religious experience.
She also said she didn't kill him.
That's
right. She didn't kill Sharon. And she also said at the parole hearing that Mr. K, who is the prosecutor, does not know who actually killed Sharon. But I can tell you who killed Sharon. Or who was the last person she saw, okay? I know psychically, okay, who it was. It was Susan Atkins.
Susan Atkins says that she didn't do the stabbing, yet in the book, The Killing of Sharon Tate, she said she couldn't do it. She told Tex to do it. Tex did it. And yet in Will You Die For Me by Tex Watson, he says that Susan did it. And it's interesting, the different chronological events and the things that happened. It was brutal. "There are 11 murders they will never solve. There were screams that night from the man on the front lawn. Oh, God, please don't. Oh, God, don't, don't, don't." There was some youth group that was camping nearby that heard 4 gunshots. The man went out into a circular fashion to check out that canyon to see if he could find out if something was wrong. It was brutal because Sharon was so delicate. And
yes,
yet she had 16 stab wounds, 5 of which were fatal. It was brutal and it was ritualistic. Are you aware that they said that they intended to dismember their bodies, but they didn't have time? They felt like their time was short? Did you know that?
No. Why did they feel their time was short?
I guess because of the noise, they kept sending someone down to the bottom of the hill for Linda Kasabian to see whether or not someone had heard the ruckus and the screaming and the yelling. In Sharon's case, severe hemorrhaging. Victim was stabbed 16 times, five of which wounds were in and of themselves fatal. The last to die, begging for her life, 8.5 months pregnant, and she was killed. They wrote pig out of her own blood.
Yes.
Susan Atkins wants to be paroled. What do you think about that? What do you think about Susan Atkins?
What do I think about?
Mm-hmm.
The parole?
The possibility.
The possibility of parole?
Is she a changed person?
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if she's a changed person she says she's a changed person. The fact is that she has 7 counts of murder against her, and you do not parole anyone who is a serial type killer. You can I can understand a crime of passion, okay? One-time killer. We cannot, as a society, trust these people ever again into a free world. It just can't be done.
Then you do not condemn nor condone their religious experience. You say it doesn't open the door to jail.
Well, that's between them and their God. It does mm-hmm. not open the doors. I mean, what deterrence do we have if we decide we're going to turn... If you turn loose the Manson family, let's turn loose Randy Kraft. He just got the death penalty, but so mm-hmm. did they. So what? Mm-hmm. Ramirez, okay? Henry Lou Lucas, who murdered his mother 8 years after. He claims 375 lives after he was released, okay? You have to open the door to all of them. So is that what we're going to do? Because they have had a religious experience? No. They can have a religious experience in the prison. They have lots of people over there they can convert.
I have showed you a letter that I received from San Luis Obispo Church.
Yes.
They are opposing the release of this video. They refuse to help us do interviews with either Tex, who they know, his wife Christine, or anyone else in that regard. And they said, you have no right to judge him or to do this video because, as a Christian, you can't judge him, so you can't talk about him. Is that fair for them to say that? What do you think about that?
We have a system in this country, and they are judged by a 12-man peers, okay? They have gone through this system. I don't have to judge them, even though it's my daughter, and who has a better right to judge them than Sharon's parents,
mm-hmm.
you know? What are these people trying to do?
Get out of jail.
For what reason?
I mean,
if they want him out of jail, again, do they want the others? They want the Ramirez's, the Randy Kraft? But they're one and the same. They're one and the same people. So if you're going to turn loose any of them, turn loose all of them.
What do you think about conjugal visits? And I ask you because during the trial, you may not know this, but while sequestered at the Ambassador Hotel, the jury mm-hmm. were allowed to have weekend conjugal visits. But guess what? Their mates had to pay the difference in the hotel bill. The court didn't pay that. We now have conjugal visits, and Tex Watson is the father of three.
And the state is paying for their conjugal visits. Okay. I mean, they're supplying the room. All mm-hmm. right.
Do you oppose that?
I oppose it for one reason.
Just him?
No. Now, remember, Bill, I am on the advisory committee mm-hmm. of the Department of Corrections to the director. I oppose this for the children that comes out of these conjugal visits. As you know, and I know, okay, we're going to say, as little children will say to little children, where's your dad? Or what does your dad do? Mine's an engineer at TRW. Or like my, I can't say that, I'm sorry.
What does Tex Watson say?
What is his children going to say? Oh, my father's in prison for murdering 9 people?
Mm-hmm.
What does this do to the mind of the child? How dare they bring an innocent child into this world with that sort of background?
Are you fearful that there may be genes there? in heredity.
All right. There is such a thing as is known as episodic aggression.
You believe in that?
I'm not sure that I do or I don't, okay?
But it's possible.
But it's very possible. If this is possible, and episodic aggression is real, these little children could have these genes. Or if episodic is brain damage, they will not. But the damage, they will not have this aggressive personality. But they are still subjected to their father in prison murdering 9 people.
When you brought this up to me, you said, if he wants to have sex, let him make a choice.
Absolutely.
Get fixed or do without.
That's right.
You still believe that?
Absolutely.
For prisoners of that kind of crime?
Of a violent. If they are in prison for life with special circumstances, okay, then they should not have conjugal visits. Unless, and it's their choice, Bill. It's their choice. If they want to have conjugal visits, then be prepared for a vasectomy. And what you have to remember also is males can be fixed.
Okay? I like the way you say that.
No, I'm sorry. Males can be repaired. Repaired is the word. Okay?
You want Tex Watson repaired.
No, I don't. I want him fixed. You know? I want him fixed.
What do you feel about his wife? Here's a woman who started corresponding with him, who now has married him and has mothered 3 children. Who knows? Maybe another one's on the way soon. What do you feel about her? Okay. Would you ever sit down and talk with her?
Sure. I do many inmates, you know. Mm-hmm. But I would have to put her in the same category as her husband. Why? Mm-hmm. I have heard them say, them being Manson and Susan Atkins, had there been no Tex Watson,
yes.
Charles Manson,
right?
There, I would not have committed these murders. They don't have the guts to stand up and say, yeah, I did it. They've got to blame it on Manson. So putting her in the same category or the mindset of these two seems right to me. They could be convinced of most anything. Where is that individuality?
You oppose them at parole hearings, specifically Susan Atkins and Tex Watson.
Right.
You do not go to Manson's parole hearings because you really don't fear that he's going to get out.
I would like to. I would like to go to his parole hearing. They don't feel they need me there. Okay, so, but I would like to go see this little guy, okay, hopping around on the tables like he does, you know? I mean, you have seen him, Bill, on the... a
lot of TV shows.
Yeah, Geraldo's show,
yeah.
That big one. And, you know, I mean, what does he do? What does he act like this? He is an adult, grown... 56-year-old man. I mean, how would you like to think about yourself jumping on the tables trying to have a conversation with me? Is that not stupid?
Or clever.
Or clever.
Depending on what you want to portray.
That's true.
Let me ask you about the parole hearings. You have one coming up.
Yes.
Tex Watson.
Yes, in May.
May 1990.
Yes.
Do you dread that?
Not at all.
Doesn't bother you to sit across from the table from Tex Watson, who butchered your daughter, and look at that man, or do you look at him? Do you dialogue with him?
I look at him.
Does he look at you?
He does not look at me.
Why?
I don't know. I really don't know why he has never just eye to eye faced me, but he never has. The first time, the first parole hearing that I was ever there, I could have... You know how Manson's eyes go black? As I review the TV cameras that was there, the film, mm-hmm. My eyes went just that black. If there was ever a time that I was almost possessed, okay, that was it. I could have killed him.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
You still have that same ability or feeling?
No.
You've gotten beyond that.
Oh, beyond. Well, beyond.
You took about 352,000 letters through the National Enquirer to the prison to see that Tex Watson didn't get set free because, was it Leslie Van Houten who...
Yes.
Who had brought 9,000 letters.
No, 900. 900 letters. And
people sympathetic to her release.
Yes, sympathetic to her release. I had always told Stephen Kay, if you need my help, all you have to do is call. He called me one day, and this was concerning Leslie Van Houten's parole hearing. Mm-hmm. Now, she was the one most likely to get
out.
To be paroled.
In fact, in honesty, didn't Stephen Kay, one of the prosecutors, suggest that she should be paroled until she married this clown and the guy was caught with prison guard uniform in his possession when he was arrested, and Stephen Kay changed his opinion?
No, I'm not. I don't know.
I've been reading again.
You've been reading again.
That's true.
You're good at that.
And I talked to Steve on the phone, and he said he now fights her parole until she's well over 40 because of that incident. He said it exercised bad judgment.
Yeah, but it's not that. You see, her attorneys continue to say that she stabbed Rosemary LaBianca after she was dead. How do they know that? How do they know that?
That would be the basis for a good parole.
Was there a physician there at the time that she was stabbing her?
You know what Tex Watson says, or Susan Atkins. Susan Atkins says that she went back into the house to get the towel to dip it in Sharon's blood and write pig on the door. And she says that the bodies were more carved up than when she had left the door. Tex Watson went on a rampage at the end of the killings and just totally attacked every dead person in there.
All I can say is thank God she was already dead.
Mm.
You know. But, I mean, that blows my mind about Leslie because that is so unreal.
Mm-hmm.
She says she was dead. Also, remember on that rampage that he hung...
All right, I'm going to cut off the interview right there. There's about 20 more minutes left of that, but we are completely... out of time. In fact, I just have a brief moment to discuss the shows that we have coming in the future. We've got a lot of exciting shows coming in the future for the rest of the year. So be sure to tune in. Be sure to tune in for part two of Doris Tate in her own words. And if you have any show topic ideas or anything like that, please tweet me on my Twitter page called @SimplyKasy. On Twitter. But until next week, have a safe week, and I'll see you then. Bye-bye.